two.
It's two. It's always whatever this is, but positive. And as we discussed last time, period equals 2 pi over b. That's 2 pi over, what's b this time?
2.
1/4 pi. 1/4 pi. Or, as I like to call it, pi over 4. 2 pi over 1 times 4 over pi. 8. The period is 8. So amplitude's 2. Mark that up. 2. Negative 2 down here. And we make that 8. It's the cosine, so it starts up here, goes through the midline, down to the minimum, through the midline, and up to the maximum again. And we travel that full cycle, that full period, through 8.
Wait.
Yes.
If the period's 8, can it take 8 to do one thing, the jig?
One full cycle to the point where if I kept going, I would just trace the same shape again and again and again. Do you mean like this?
Yes.
That'd be half of a cycle. Once you've made a shape that you can pretty much just like copy and paste and continue on, that's one full period.
Can we do that?
Copy and paste it? Why not? If we did that, then where would this be?
Negative 4.
Where would this be?
-2.
-2 with this one. Yeah.
So the mermen are holding hands.
What is this?
I'm curious why.
Why not mermen?
Because we have waves. You having waves?
Oh,
yeah. I was thinking water, but okay.
A lot of things.
No, water makes up waves.
No, it don't.
Well, when, what are sound waves made of?
Water.
That is
what sound. Sound waves aren't made of anything specific. Sound waves can like be in water or anything mattery.
Mattery.
All right. Let's get on to the new business.
Please.
And,
do we have a quiz?
Nope, we don't.
Oh, thank goodness.
Can we take one?
No.
We're
doing
it especially
nope.
For you in math.
You got it.
I don't have time for math philosophy club until the end of track.
No.
Well, then that, once that's over, then we'll all be happy. We can have math philosophy club.
All right. Back
so, a quick review of last time. That's what I'm going to do first. You ready for that?
I haven't
done this. Okay, so last time we had this. We could multiply the sine of the cosine by a. Okay, and what did a change?
Change the
amplitude. So if I change a here, I change the amplitude. If I change it to negative, then I get an upside down sign. Upside down if it's negative.
They look the same.
If it's bigger, it's bigger. If it's smaller, it's smaller, right? This is 0.2,
wait,
so 1/5.
Can you make the sine a flat line on the right side?
Okay, if we make this 0,
so
then it's just always the sine of 0, which is 0.
Can you do that again?
Flat line 0.
So if we change it, does the, okay, good, yeah.
Tangent now.
I just want to know if it makes it longer.
Okay, so no matter what I do with A, like nothing changes except for how tall it is. Alright. That should stop. Alright, so that's one. What about B? What does B change when I change B?
How far?
Period. Yeah. Period is bigger B, smaller period, right?
Dang.
Bigger the B is, the smaller the period is, the smaller time it takes to go through one cycle, because what you're doing is you're taking whatever angle you put in there and you're making it even bigger. If I put pi in there, all of a sudden it's, well, if I put pi, well, in this one, if I put pi in there, Only put in pi, but all of a sudden it's 7 pi, right? And at 7 pi, it's gone through like a lot of changes.
Yeah.
So, this, what's the period of this function?
The period?
Nope.
2 pi over 7.
2 pi over 7.
Okay.
2 pi over 7, that's not very big. Okay. 2 pi over 7 is not a big angle. So, it's right here. It's gone through one full period in 2 pi over 7 radians. That's even before the normal graph gets to 1. That happens at pi over 2. Yeah, that's pi over 2. Happens at pi over 2. This is already done one full cycle and almost another by the time the first sine graph gets up to 1.
How big can you make that number?
To 10. It goes up to 10, it just gets smaller, and if I made it bigger, it'd be smaller and smaller and smaller, the period would be. And then we see it gets flipped over the y-axis.
That's why you're flipping it.
Now, if we go to negative 1, you can see it's exactly the same, except for it's flipped horizontally, it's flipped over the y-axis.
So human DNA is sine and cosine.
They're missing one more
detail
for damage.
Those are the tangents.
Alright. So that's a quick review of last time. Now this time, we're going to affect other things. We affect the amplitude of the period. That's what A and B will do. If you multiply the sine by something, you'll affect the amplitude. If you multiply the angle by something, you'll affect the period. If I'm inside the sine function with x, and I subtract h, that'll have an effect. Or if I'm outside and I add k, it'll have a different kind of effect. What do you think about for k? If h is 0, so let's not worry about h yet. But what if I plug in some different k? If I put sine of x, close parentheses, plus 2, what do you think the effect of that would be?
You move the thing when you got me down.
Yeah. We did that one, right? That was our guess. We're changing the period last time, and then it turns out that it moved up and down. So let's see what happens when we change k. That's the number that we're adding here. If we add 1,
yep,
it moves up 1.
It levitates.
2, 3, 4.
Levitates.
Well, up and down, and we'll see if there's anything.
Come back down.
Hit play on all of them at the same time.
Clapping.
Will it stop when you get back to nil?
No. It keeps going forever. Okay, then. Just even like almost process of elimination here. A, this A right here, changes the amplitude. Okay. B changes the period. K has shifted up and down.
H will shift it left and right.
Shift left and right.
Even though if you move it very, very far, nothing happens.
It will look like nothing has happened. How far will I have to move it in one direction? Like, how big will h have to be?
2 over 7.
It's just
2 pi over 7.
Why do you say that?
Because that's what I think that you get.
It
was.
Was, but it is not now.
You'll have to move it 2 pi.
Pi? How big is pi?
3.14.
Okay, let's move it to 3.14. 3.1.
Okay, so you will have to move it.
2 pi. How big would that be?
Why do we have to move it 2
8?
Pi?
Huh?
Why not just pi? Why do we have to move it 2 pi?
Because of
2 pi is the period. Not pi. 2 pi is a full period. So we moved it. Watch that middle point. This one right here. Move it to the right. Pi. It's where pi is now. That's halfway through the cycle. So if we move it to 6.28 or 6.3, it looks like it's just lying on top of the original.
Looks a little bit off. That's just because of
estimation. Yeah, maybe, or maybe because it can only do tenths. So
yeah.
6.3 is just a little bit off 6.28. That's an interesting result. So yeah, depending on what we add, we may actually wind up with exactly the same graph. If it's just right, it just pushes it.
it over so it lays on top of what would normally be the side. Okay? Alright. Before I show you the next thing, let's play all these at once. That's just fun.
That would be so off.
I think it's funny that the fact that the blue line is just kind of like bouncing back and forth.
It's like a DVD screensaver.
Yeah, it's like vertical.
I want that screensaver.
You can make it to do this.
And then the other one just looks really awkward.
Alright.
Give me a headache.
Okay, so now when when we mess around with this a little bit, which we will, you know, just ease into it, then we can put all four of those things together. And I'll have this back at one. So this is the normal sine of x, right? A is 1, b is 1, h is 0, k is 0, so there's essentially nothing there. But if we, it looks complicated, but each thing serves its individual purpose, okay? So if we look at it that way, just break it down into its individual pieces, it's not that difficult to graph. If we change A, we change the amplitude. Change B, we change the period. If we change H, we move left and right. Okay, notice when I move, say, to the right 2, all right, let's do like 1.7. I'll put this back in.
It's not half of pi.
Am I wrong about that? Oh, yeah.
What's 31 divided by 2? And then move your decimal place over. Yeah, you're right.
You were close.
Putting up
one
cigar.
Ah, yeah, that mental math.
Anyway, we can move it left or right. Notice if I move it, if I make h 1.6 or whatever, like, the bigger I make h, the more to the right
it
goes. Wait,
if you 1.6, you suddenly have cosine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does look the same. And that's okay. Well, it looks like negative cosine. Now it looks like cosine. That's at the top. So the bigger h is, the more it moves to the right. If h goes negative, it moves to the left. But notice h is subtracted. Okay. So if I make this h positive, it's actually minus 3. It's moved to the right 3 when I subtract. This way, it moves to the left 4.8, but that's because I'm subtracting negative 4.8. So that might actually look like in real life plus 4.8. Because I'm translating to a left, a horizontal shift to the left. And then if we change k, it moves up and down.
Wait, 1 plus 4.8, move it to the right?
I can explain it after you do a couple of shifts and all. Okay, so let's investigate a horizontal shift and see why it shifts it to the, well, the opposite way you would think. Okay, let's start with that.
Y equals the sine of
7.
2.
No. 6.
5.
X minus
7.
Pi over 2. So let's make it easier than that. Let's just do pi, not pi over 2.
Thank you.
Minus pi.
Why is pi from you?
Feeling good today.
Right, so I will tell you that we should expect a shift to the right pi. You might think it should be to the left, but I want to help you understand why it's to the right instead of the left. So let's graph the normal sine function. It goes like this, this, that. There's 2 pi.
Just not with the D.
There's 3 pi over 2, pi, and pi over 2. That's your normal, run in the middle, sine of x. Change the colors here. And y equals the sine of x. Okay. Not sine of x minus pi. Change this to something else. Get it color coded. So why will the sine of x minus pi be shifted to the right pi instead of to the left pi? You know what? I'm gonna go back to pi over 2. Let me see. Shifted to the right pi or to the left pi, it'll look like the same thing happened. So we needed to use pi over 2 so we can see a difference. So if this shifted to the left pi over 2 like you would think...
Wait, if the full cycle is pi, then if we shifted it to the left or right pi...
The full cycle is 2 pi, not pi.
Yeah, so if we shifted to the left or the right pi, it would only be halfway.
It would be the inverse. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it'd look like the inverse.
It would look like it was flipped upside down.
Yeah.
But if I move it to the right pi or to the left pi, it'll get that same look.
What?
Let me show you here. So we get everything back to normal.
What's normal?
Make sure 0 for a second. Okay. So we'll shift it to the right pi. That's about 3 points. Okay, so that's to the right. That's the blue one. You see how they just kind of perfectly do the opposite of each other. If I move it to the left, okay, so here is not moved, and now I move it to the left, pi, it looks the same.
Oh, you're right. I see what you're trying to say now.
Whether I move it to the right pi or to the left pi, it looks the same. Different things happen, but it looks the same. So I
want
to do pi over 2, so it doesn't.
What would it look like if that pi divided by 2?
Well, how big is pi over 2?
About 1.6.
About 1.6, so move it to the right, 1.6. It looks like that. Okay. And if I were to move it to the left, 1.6,
it's different. It's different than it would be if it was moved to the right.
Now blue is in front of red. Before red was in front of blue.
Or stop being philosophical.
Okay, so if it moved to the left pi over 2, it would look like this guy right here that's at pi over 2 would move to the left and be at 0. Okay, so that's what that would look like. It would look like the cosine wave. But if it were moved to the right pi over 2, then this guy would move over from 0 to pi over 2, and that would definitely look different. Okay. So let's see why it does just that, why it moves to the right and not left. Okay. And to me, it comes down to this part right there, where the inside of the parentheses is 0. Okay, it's kind of like the middle of the graph. It's not really the middle to a sine wave because it repeats over and over and over. But there's kind of a middle.
Is there a middle to anything?
Can't get into this discussion.
Philosophy.
Okay. So if I'm taking the sine of 0, then I get this point right here, right? The sine of 0 is 0. Right? But in this case, what do I have to plug in for x to get 0?
I have to find
pi over 2. So that the x value that causes us to get sine of 0, and therefore the y value is 0, meaning we're on the x-axis.
Well, what do you have to block this is?
What?
I said, well, what an unathletic block this is.
Okay, so if we plug in pi over 2, right, which is pi over 2 bigger than 0, if we We plug in pi over 2, we subtract pi over 2, we get sine of 0, and we get 0. So it's at pi over 2. And when we plug that in, we subtract pi over 2, we get 0.
So the middle of the graph has become pi over 2.
So the middle of the graph has become to the right pi over 2.
Well, that just got funky.
So now if we plug in pi, let's see what happens then. Y equals the sine of pi minus pi over 2. That's the sine of pi over 2. If we get a common denominator, it's that. What's the sine of pi over 2? Got your unit circle.
I knew that we're going heavy. Right here, yes.
Wrong one.
One.
It's the y value. Okay? So it's 1. So now we plug in pi, and we subtract pi over 2. And so suddenly when we plug in pi, we get pi over 2 inside the sine function, and we get 1. So what we're seeing is we have to put in x values that are offset by pi over 2. Because when we plug in that number, we're going to get pi over 2 subtracted off of it. It's going to be pi over 2 less than what we plugged in. Okay, so we have to plug in these bigger values to compensate for the what's going to get subtracted off. Does that make sense, Gordon?
Yes.
That's why it moves to the right. And likewise, if you add on something, you want to put in smaller values so that when it adds on, that's where you find your center.
This is like when we graphed before, but we weren't graphing this.
We were graphing, yeah, this is...
Yeah, I remember what you said.
Yeah, like the parabolas or the square root functions, the quadratic functions, or you know, all those guys. Yeah, we do the same thing every time. Now with the trig functions, the horizontal shifts are a little bit trickier if we do a horizontal shift and a period change at the same time. So yeah, if we had
freeze.
Sine of bx, we would get a change in the period.
Yeah.
But if we also, before we multiply by b, we subtract something off of x, then we're going to get a shift and a period change.
And then really often,
it's going to be. And you can imagine if you like shrink something down and shift it to the left and right, that can cause some issues. So we have to go about this like in the right order just so we don't mix anything up. Alright. So let's do you guys wanna if you need to practice a horizontal shift, do you think you got the idea?
Should we try higher? No, we got the idea. Let's move on.
No. I bet you don't do as well as you think you would do. Okay. Why? Equals cosine of x plus pi over 4. Alright. So to help you see this, why shifts to the left, we made this little chart. We've made these charts many, many times. Especially with like the square root functions, I think we did that.
Why do we do everything in radians?
Because they're superior in every way. All right, so we're just going to take a look at the normal cosine function just to get an idea of what kind of x values we are going to want to find. Normally, we like these values. Pi over 2, pi, 3 pi over 2, and 2 pi, because that's where these key things are happening. Easy to find cosine values happen at these places. So maximum, through midline, through the minimum, through the midline again, and up to the maximum.
So that's a normal one.
That's a normal one. This is y equals the cosine of x normal. So what I'm sharing with you over here, see, not x plus 4, x plus pi. Excuse me. This represents what is in the parentheses, right? What you're taking the cosine of. We like to take the cosine of 0, the cosine of pi over 2, the cosine of pi, the cosine of 3 pi over 2, the cosine of 2 pi. Remember back when we were taking the square roots, we like to take the square roots of 4 and 9 and 36 and 25, these numbers, because you can take the square root of. Okay. Not that other things don't have square roots, they're just harder to find. Same thing here, the cosine. Lots of angles have cosines, actually all angles have cosines. But we like to take the cosine of some particular angles.
Hello?
The angles that we like to take the cosine of just because they are simple. 0, pi over 2, right? Cosine of 0 is 1. The cosine of pi over 2 is 0. These are simple. Cosine of pi is negative 1. Cosine of 3 pi over 2 is again 0. And 2 pi, cosine of 2 pi is back to 1. We would always like to take the cosine or the sine of these five values. Does that make sense? Like the cosine of 45 is root 2 over 2. Who wants to deal with that? Who wants to put pi over 4 on the graph? Pi over 6 and pi over 3, they're just at awkward positions, and they're worth things like root 3 over 2. Sometimes a half, but a half is not as good as one. So we like these values to be put into the function. But the thing is, that's what we want to take the cosine of. What do we have to put in for x in order to take the cosine of 0, for instance?
Pi over 4 from every one of them.
From every one of them, that's right. Put in negative pi over 4, and when you add pi over 4, you'll get 0. What do you have to put in to get pi over 2?
Negative pi over
2. No.
Pi over 4.
Pi over 4.
And then 3 pi over 4.
3 pi over 4 minus pi over 4 will give us 2 pi over 4, or no, 3 pi over 4 plus pi over 4, 4 pi over 4 will give us pi. You got it.
Yes.
3 pi over 4. How about to get 3 pi over 2?
2 pi.
2 pi.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No. It's going to have to be 4 pi over 4.
1 and 3 quarters pi over 2.
Okay. How many pi over 4 is that?
5
pi over 4?
Yes.
Good. 5 pi over 4. 5 pi over 4 plus pi over 4, that's 6 pi over 4, 3 pi over 2.
And then 7 pi over 4 for.
Yeah. Okay, so what have these values done? What were they? This one is for the standard cosine of x over there. You see it in red. These are the values we like. We have to go back pi over 4 so that when we add pi over 4, we get back to those values that we like. Negative pi over 4, pi over 4, 3 pi over 4. So now we just have to graph those. A mark of that size is pi over 2, so pi over 4, that would be in between all of these. So negative pi over 4 would be right here, so that's where our graph will begin. Positive pi over 4 is right here, that's where it will cross the x-axis. 3 pi over 4 is right there, that's where it will be at its minimum. Where am I getting? 3 pi over 5 pi over 4. 5 pi over 4 to cross over the x-axis again. And at 7 pi over 4, it'll be at its maximum.
It can't be pointing.
It shouldn't be. It should be ashamed if it's. Alright. There is kind of a tricky horizontal shift. Because we have to find common boundaries and stuff. If you weren't sure how to get these values, say you're at 3 pi over 2, you're not sure how to find 5 pi over 4, well, we know it's going to go from 3 pi over 2 to the left pi over 4. So we can take 3 pi over 2 minus pi over 4. That's going to give us this area here. We need to get common denominators, 6 pi over 4 minus pi over 4. 5 pi over 4.
No, that's just, there's a little bit of work that goes into finding all those key points. So, just get ready for that to take a minute or two. That's just the way it's going to be.
Can we do another one?
We're going to find these five key points, and then we're going to move them to the left. Let's do that, but let's do it with a period change. Y equals the sine of, so we got 2 times the variable, that's going to change the period, and we'll do x minus pi over 3. Okay, now the first thing is going to be find, that's not a word, find p. P is always equal to pi over b. That is b. There you go. Then, okay, so I guess we'll find the period and we'll graph it. What we're really graphing is y equals the sine of 2x, meaning the first thing we'll graph, the first thing we'll consider, the first values we'll look at will be without the shift, just the period change. After we change the period, or we stretch it out, or we shrink it down, then we'll move it to the left or right, as we need to. We're going to move left or right, and by how much in this case?
To
the right.
Pi over 3.
Right, pi over 3. But first, what we're going to do is what I said right here. We're going to find the period, and we're going to graph it with just the period change. P equals 2 pi over 2 is pi. This red, graph it in red. I guess in general, graphing y equals bx, so we'll graph y equals 2x here. So it's got a period of pi. So we'll mark off. I like to cut these things into 4 pieces because there's those 4 key intervals that make it easy to graph. So the full period will be pi. It's the sine wave, so we'll go from here to the maximum, down to the midline, down to the minimum, up to the midline again. That's a full period. That'd be pi over 2, that'd be pi over 4, that'd be 3 pi over 4. Who is not with me?
Wait, give me a second.
I don't mean like in spirit. I just mean.
Yeah, if you're confused.
So, when you find the p, when you got 2, which you was pi, pi is the furthest you go, which makes one full thing. So it's the very end.
Cycle, yeah. Well, it's not really an end. You keep going, you know that.
But I just mean like for one full cycle.
For one full thing, which makes it easier to graph, yeah. But really, it keeps going, but we don't have all the time in the world to keep graphing.
Wait, is that a normal sign that you just graphed?
That is.
That hasn't been shifted yet.
Hasn't been shifted, but it has had the period change.
Yeah.
Y equals the sine of 2x.
Do we know what the a is?
A is 1 here.
Just 1?
Right, there's no different a than normal.
Alright, so when
shouldn't
you don't know
a
it,
third?
You put a.
Well, that's the thing that's tricky about this shift, is that the period change was caused it to break down in fourths most easily, but the shift is in thirds, so
that
makes a little bit of a challenge. But you know, what's life without challenges?
Easy.
Too easy, in fact.
It's Gavin.
Okay, so we're gonna take every one of these values and shift them over by pi over 3.
That doesn't make sense.
Why not?
Because we're in fourths.
Oh. Well, I don't like it either, but
You created this monster.
Yeah. I don't really have any out there. I did make this up. But I did it on...
Okay.
So you admit it.
I do.
Alright, so it's going to shift to the right pi over 3, so we should just... Just tentatively, we should see... Come on now.
It hates you.
It does. We should see it shift over to somewhere in that neighborhood. That's not our real one. Faded into the background. You should see it shift to the right that much. Well, if we want to shift everything to the right, pi over 3, then we should go to every one of these x values and add pi over 3 to it, so we'll know where it is when we shift it to the right pi over 3. That make sense? Why don't you guys do that? Take each one of those five, add pi over 3 to each of them, and figure out where those points are going to be. Okay, you can see I tried to color code my work. You can see the color corresponds to the color of the dot there. So, for instance, the one that is at 3 pi over 4, added pi over 3 to that, and that would put it at 13 pi over 12 when we find a common denominator and add it together. Okay. I think it might make this a little easier since this is in twelfths. Let's turn all of them into twelfths, and then we can make marks of twelfths, and then we can count them that way. So this one would be 16 pi over 12. This one would be 10 pi over 12. That one's done. And this one would be 4 pi over 12. So it'll be a little easier. So 12. That would be cutting pi over 4s into thirds, and those would be pi over 12s. Pi over 4, pi over 4, pi over 4. And these would be pi over 12s. Okay. So this one was at 0. It does shift over to 4 pi over 12. 1, 2, 3, 4 pi over 12. This guy in yellow shifts over to 7 pi over 12. 5, 6, 7 pi over 12. That one up here. And 1, that's going to be at 10 pi over 12. Let's see, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is actually the full period of the graph we want. I know that's kind of a hassle, but that is the worst that it gets, is a period change and a horizontal shift at the same time where we have to...
Taking out twelfths?
Taking it out to twelfths. So
because twelves make up the universe.
We can make all of the radians out of twelfths. Fourths and thirds and sixths.
So the moral of the story is the Babylonians were smarter than everyone else.
That's not the lesson I'm teaching.
So are we going to these kinds of problems on homework?
Yeah. But there's a... So for every problem that you have in homework, I... just change the numbers a little bit and
together a video for each one. Okay, even the word problem, I just kind of changed it to a different kind of a word problem. So that's there. So if you can follow along with me in the video, you should be able to just change the numbers around. And I see what you did there, so this is what I'm going to do for my problem. Okay. So that's on the algebra 2, not algebra 2 lectures, but algebra 2.
Tuesday
to help you out.
Alright,
well, here's what we can do now. Now that we have all this, these tools, we have shifting up and down, left and right, amplitude change, and period change, we can actually write cyclical models.
Wait, why would we want to do it?
It's fun. So, do you remember the like the things that we discussed that happen in cycles last time? Are you ready?
The ocean.
The height of a wave in the ocean.
The temperature during seasons.
Temperature during the different months, maybe? Okay. That's actually the one I'm going to talk about. Okay? So, this model, the temperature on any given month, okay, it incorporates all this stuff. The amplitude has to change. We got to shift it up. We got to change the period, and we got to shift it left or right depending on what we want it to look like. Okay, so let's just dive in there and find all the pieces that we need to find,
and then stick them together.
So we're gonna use this. Y equals A times the sine of B times X minus H plus K. Now let's start with what we have already done, which is find the period. So if we're going to do this for the temperature in a given month, what do we want the period to be? We don't want the period to be 2 pi. We don't want it to be pi over 2. Like, what do we want the period to be if we're talking about the temperature in a year?
Over a year.
12 months, sure. 365 days, we can do, right? We want the period to be some measure of a year, right? And we'd like to break that year into pieces,
yeah.
Right? Months is pretty good. Weeks, days,
seasons.
A little bit too small.
Seasons breaks it down into months.
That's true.
Yeah,
we go 12.
Sometimes small is not that great.
All right, so we want the period to be 12 for 12 months. And we know that period is equal to 2 pi over b. And as I just said, we want the period to be 12. Multiply by b on both sides. Solve for b, we get pi over 6. So now we know what b should be. Okay, we can throw that in there. Now we have a function that has a period of 12, so it does a full cycle in 12 rather than in 2 pi. The normal sine wave goes up and down between what two values? Up and down between 1 and down to
-1.
Is that what temperatures do?
No.
Temperatures go up to what would you say? At the max?
105. 105? I've seen
108. Yeah, definitely go up a little bit higher.
Like
108?
Yeah.
108. I can't resist. 108. Okay, how far down does it go? How small does it have to be?
-76.
-40.
That's the month.
40?
35.
Whoa.
435?
No, just
35. Oh, -35?
Yeah.
When have you guys experienced that?
Great falls
are coming back. Great falls. What about
years?
The record for Missoula is -76 with wind chill.
No wind chill. And looking for records.
-30.
You think on average you get to -30 every year?
Average?
If you
no, like
stay
our
in the
bottom.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm saying average.
15, 20. I'd say
below.
Below?
Negative 7.
Oh, below?
Negative 10.
You have to make sure most years are completely on the charts. That way you can say the temperature is off the charts, but they say that every year, then that's not much.
Just don't listen to Gordon.
Alright.
Just don't listen to Tyler because he's a fool.
No, I'm not a fool.
Everybody calm down. What does this have an effect on? If it goes up to 108 and down to negative 20, that's going to change...
Amplitude.
Amplitude, definitely. Amplitude used to be 1, now it should be, well, bigger than that. Well, it's also... It's going way up here and coming down below just a little bit. So what else does that change? The up and down, it shifts it up and down, right? It shifts that midline up somewhere. So we got to find where that midline is. We got to find what that amplitude is as well. So if this is 108,
64,
and this is negative 20, what'd you got?
64.
Yes, and how did you get right?
I added 20 to 108 and divided by 2.
But
64
to 20.
Yeah, but you take the absolute value. What?
Well, if you did 20 plus 108, you'd be getting and divide by 2, right? And you'd be getting the average between the numbers 108 and positive 20. If I give you $20 one day and $108 the next day, and you want to find the average of those two, you would add 108 and 20 and divide by 2, right?
Okay.
So it's like trying to find.
You
want to
find the average between 108 and negative 20.
It'll be 64 from negative 20. It'll be 64
above,
plus
yes,
negative 20.
64
so
above negative 20.
44.
44. Let's also confirm that by taking 108 minus 20, which is
88.
And divided
by
2.
Yeah,
44.
44.
Okay.
Because they're all
double confirmed. So what is 44?
The
It's K. It's the midline here. It's K. So K is equal to 44. Okay. What about A? A is the what?
Amplitude.
So what is this? A.
That'd also be 40.
From here to here is 44.
It'd be 64.
Yeah. 64.
So it'd be the average that Gordon did get.
Yeah.
So you got something, Gordon. There's the wrong thing.
No, I got the right thing. Just
so you got A, we got K, we got B. Let's write what we have so far.
Y equals... 64 sine of
pi over 6.
Pi over 6 x plus 44.
Yes.
Now let's see what we need out of h. So it goes up to 108, goes down to negative 20. It's a sine wave, so we start right at the midline. We go up, down.
Are you in the
mind what?
What about K?
This is K right here. It's just about 44.
Oh, right now.
So this is 44 right here.
Suck them.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
So far, we changed the period. That's why this is 12 rather than 2 pi. This is 6. This is right in the middle. 12 months, 6 months. And let's see, we've also raised it up and changed the amplitude so that the average temperature is 44 and the rise in temperature would be up 64 degrees or the drop in temperature from the average would be down 64 degrees to negative 20. Right? But here's the thing that our model is messed up on. Let's take a look at this. So that's 44 degrees, right?
Yeah.
And it's going up from there?
Well.
What time of year does that happen? Are you at the middle, like the average temperature, and it's rising?
Spring.
Spring.
In spring. You're getting like middle of the road temperatures, and it's getting warmer heading into summer.
We have that at zero, which would be more like January.
Zero is more like, yeah, December, January. That Is spring in January? December in January?
No.
Okay, so we got a problem.
So that'd be like one every month.
What's that?
So that'd be like if the temperature thing happened every month.
The temperature thing? What do you mean?
I mean like that.
So we need to subtract something.
Period.
X.
It's just that the part of the graph is at the wrong time of year.
So we're just
we need to
shift it over.
So where should this be? And where should we shift it over to?
Shift it over 3 months.
Like, yeah, to, let's say mark.
A quarter of a period.
For like three, I guess.
So 3 months.
Yeah.
So about a quarter of a period.
So we need this to be three. So we'll move this over so we can make room for that. Parentheses around our x, minus three. So it moves it to the right three. So it takes this from zero over over three. That'd be right about there.
So then it goes down to down to this.
So now it's more like pretty cold. Maybe it's coldest around December, January. Do you think it's coldest December, January? Yeah, it's pretty cold then. I mean, it's a pretty good model.
Grabs it on the calculator, it looks really scary.
Oh, nice.
I figured out how to add up the numbers 1 through 9 so that they come out to 15 in every direction.
Why would you want that?
So,
okay. So, let me just do this real quick.
One.
Okay, then.
All right. See if I can remember all this. So, if we go back over here, we change A to 65. B was what?
B was
pi over 6. H was?
3.
And K?
44.
Now, this should model the temperatures throughout the year. All right, I'm going to change these axes to something that makes more sense, like...
Summer 78 degrees again.
What's that? Okay, so let's just look at a point on the graph and see if we agree. Somewhere between 0 and 12. So right there, 8.27 and 68.24 degrees. When would 8.27 be?
Well, it's going down, so I fall.
Mid-August.
August, so July, August is 8.27, a little bit into August. And 68.24, do we get temperatures of 68.24 into August?
Yeah.
Yes. Pretty warm in August. Not as warm as July, like up here. Okay. Heading into, getting closer to, that's June. Is it hottest in June?
No.
July. So
we're like a month off.
Hot in July. So maybe we should minus four.
Four.
July's
pretty hot.
Now it's hottest in July. July is 109. Okay, that makes sense. Oh, how'd I do that?
Now mid-August would be about
50 degrees.
Let's see, August, what would it be,
97.15?
Yeah.
Which is still pretty good.
This
is so weird. Yeah.
Still makes sense. Like the 60-something was a bit low.
It's a bit low. Yeah, August is pretty hot.
Yeah, August is very hot.
Okay. Well, that's
why all fires burn all the time in August.
What?
The forest fires.
That's
just the entire valley smoking.
What's on
here for August because it's
hot.
Spent all summer being hot.
Stuart, you and Brandon have rabbits growing from your face.
What?
Gordon, go
home.
Gordon, oh my god.
Gordon, you're gonna find out there's something different about your brain.
Yeah, he doesn't have one.
Have a brain to think
like
that. Maybe it's just like a
can
do the next problem?
No.
We don't have time.
But I want to give you time to work on your homework. That's what we're going to do right now.
Okay.
Remember that when you look at one of those equations and it looks like there's so many numbers, remember each number serves a purpose. Let's summarize it real quick.
There's so many numbers.
You might have A times sine, and this goes for the cosine as well. I'll write that here. That was the cosine. B times x minus h. It'll be the same here. X minus h. Plus k, it's all the same. Okay? For both of these, what does k do?
That moves it vertically.
Vertically. Vertical shift. Not stretching it out, not making it taller like the amplitude does, which we'll go ahead and note. But just moving it up and down. Now this guy stretches it out vertically, changes the amplitude, changes how far it'll go from the midline to the maximum. Okay. How about B? What does this guy do?
Period.
Period equals 2 pi over B. And lastly, H.
Horizontal
shift.
I just came up with something.
What'd you come up with?
Is a horizontally challenged person really fat or really skinny?
Skinny because they're challenged and it's harder.
Yes.
Harder to go horizontal.
If
so
you're vertically challenged,
either or.
If you're vertically challenged, you're short.
Yeah.
So it's less. If you're horizontally challenged, it'd
but
be less.
When you graph a sine equation, it goes from the